Speaking. Good morning, everyone. See, myself, Dr. Sudeep. I am pediatric cardiologist from King's Hospital, Secunderabad. This is my first class, so I just want to go through some of the quiz questions from the X-ray, ECG, cath, as well as from the echo. I just like one thing from you, after that, just please give me the feedback, how it was and how I can improve over there. So this is just an informal thing, first to begin with, because I am always mesmerized with all these characters. So just start the quiz with this. So this is just to identify 5 out of 8 characters. Just which is your favorite. This is not the pediatric cardiology question, but just a general knowledge for all of you. So can you please tell me, out of these 8 characters, how much you can identify and which is your favorite? So I want answers from you on this also. So I just tell you this. See, I'm not getting much answer except from one of the fellows. So first of all, it's very famous Sherlock Holmes. Second is one of the very famous character in the Bengali literature, from which is Vyomkesh Bakshi. Third is Feluda. It's very less known, but it's one of the very famous character created by Satyajit Ray. Karamchand, everyone knows. Nancy Drew, Agatha Christie, Hardy Boys, and Tintin. So you must be thinking why I'm telling all this. So just to tell, Hello? So, why
hello? Anybody can hear?
Hello?
Oh, anybody can hear him? Doctor, can you hear me?
I am able to hear you. Because whenever we are having, being a doctor, we should have some detective eye to take small clues to take from all our findings. So we are always mentioning all these characters. We should imbibe some of the character of this. So one of these are the two most of the famous what we call is the quiz contestant of quiz masters in India, like Derek Oberon and Siddharth Basu. So just with that introduction, I'll go with the first of our slide. So this is start with the X-ray. So you can tell within, we'll give you 5 to 10 seconds for each slide. Then you have to type your answers over there. So the 6-year-old boy is symptomatic with dyspnea, unequal pulses, and severe elbow dysfunction. And this is the X-ray. Can you please tell me what is the most important X-ray finding in this X-ray? No. Hello. So this is, now you can see some people write directed descending aorta. Aortic shed or FDTA. But the most important we are unable to show, it's irregular aorta. And you can see the dense calcification over there. So it's a aortic shadow we'll see, but there is a calcification with irregular dilated aorta. That is the characteristic after the burned out phase of the Takayasu arthritis, we'll get the calcification of the aorta. So this is the typical calcification with irregular aorta. So unequal pulses, severe elbow dysfunction, although it's a boy, but it can having present in both girls and the boys, also having more predilection for the girls. This is the one of the typical X-ray of the Takayasu arthritis with calcification. So it's an aortic shadow, dilated descending aorta is okay, but apart from that, there is a calcification in the aorta. This is the first X-ray. Now we'll go to the second X-ray. This is a 23-year-old cyanotic CSD, single ventricular pulmonary stenosis physiology, and ankle joint tenderness. So what is your diagnosis in this? You have to remember, any cyanotic CSD, what will be the cause of the joint tenderness? So there are only 2 or 3 causes for that. So I just like to know from you, what is your diagnosis after seeing these 2 X-rays? So tell me the X-ray findings also. So this is actually ankle joint tenderness, and this is a type 4 clubbing, what we are calling it as synotic arthropathy with type 4 clubbing. The type 4 clubbing consists of periosteal reaction because of the hypoxia continuous. So it's a hypertrophic osteodystrophy, what we call it, type 4 clubbing, grade 4 clubbing. And that consists of clinical triad of clubbing, arthralgia, and the periosteitis, in which tibia is invariably involved. So this is the typical X-ray where you can, I just marked with the box, you can see there is a periosteal reaction at the distal end of the tibia that is causing the arthritis. It's not a gouty arthritis, because gout you won't get the periosteitis. But this is a typical periosteitis of the grade 4 hypertrophic osteoarthropathy because of the cyanosis. That is known as grade 4 clubbing, which is not related to the cardiology. But what are hypocratic fingers known as? What the hypocratic finger refers to? Any answer? Anyone want to like to try over this? What are hypocratic fingers? I didn't get any answer till now. This is a very simple one. Hippocratic fingers are just the second name for the clubbed fingers. Clubbing has got, because of first described by Hippocrates, so that's why it's known as the Hippocratic finger. We'll go to the next one. See, tell me that this is the X-ray. This is the X-ray of one of the patients and which having cyanosis. So tell me the only, these are the three questions associated with this X-ray. Tell me the only cyanotic CSD with inconspicuous aorta and pulmonary artery. And this X-ray is for that condition. What are the typical pattern of this X-ray known as? And what are the two extremely closest GD and one extremely closest GD for that? That's correct. What Dr. Abhinav and Sandeep told. What this typical X-ray pattern known as? This is a typical box shape part, and remember, this is the only cyanotic condition without conspicuous. There is no prominent aorta as well as PA, both are small. And this is the closest GD will be water bottle and the pericardial collection. That is also correct. So what the pericardial collection and box and abstinence, we can differentiate. How you differentiate? See, how you will tell this is the abstinence or pericardial collection? First, there is no SVC dilatation here, there is no aorta seen, there is no PA seen. And second thing, the vascularity is more or less decreased here. Once the vascularity is maintained with the very sharp cardiophrenic angle, that is the typical of the pericardial effusion. So that is known as the water bottle sign or the money bag sign in the pericardial collection. This is the typical water box shaped heart of the ST. So this is decreased vascularity. This is because of the RVOT. This is the huge RA, and that is known as the box shaped heart of the Epstein, and the most common GD is pericardial collection. Very correct from all of you. So now this is just cardiomegaly. This is the one X-ray of a 1-year-old child having cardiomegaly with increased vascularity and diagnosis tricuspid. But there is some incidental finding on this X-ray. Can you please tell me what's the incidental finding on this X-ray, which is found only in 10% cases, which is most commonly found in the females and having incidence of 0.2 to 0.5% in general population. Because apart from seeing the X-ray, somebody connected accessory rib, okay. Cervical rib is the correct answer, because this is the cervical rib. Just this is to highlight, rather than seeing the X-ray pertaining to the heart, we have to see other things also. Because in 10% of the cases, the cervical rib may cause your thoracic outlet syndrome and cause some of the symptoms. So this is just the accidental finding. You have to see the X-ray from inside to outside. There are two approaches, either centrifugal approach or centripetal approach. So whenever you form, you have to find out all of the findings in the X-ray. So very correct. 6 days old child with distress and 3 days old child with distress. What is X-ray better known as, and what are the two differential diagnoses for this X-ray? Anyone? HMD, okay. Ground glass appearance. Ground glass is little different, although you can call it as ground glass, but this is pattern known as the reticular pattern of the TAPVC. And the other diagnosis is HMD, okay. And the other two diagnoses are group B, streptococcal and the hyaline membrane diseases. So ground glass, the first one is typical ground glass with reticular pattern. Second one is no typical ground glass, but there is a reticular pattern. There is a slight difference between ground glass. Ground glass is more hazy with less reticular pattern. Although the pathology will be the same, but the ground glass appearance and reticular pattern are little different, but although they can found in the similar condition. So that's correct from all of you. So these are the typical pattern we'll see in the obstructive TAPVC. Or group B streptococcal infection, which is rare in India, and the hyaline membrane diseases of the newborn. Very correct. Now this is the X-ray 2-year-old child with central sinuses, clubbing and continuous murmur. Origin and cause for continuous murmur. Can you please tell me? Okay. See, you have to take the clue from the X-ray. That's what the meaning of X-ray. Somebody is writing MAPKAs, collaterals, you have to take the clues. What are the clues in the X-ray? 2-year-old with cyanosis, clubbing and still continuous murmur. So what you all wrote is extremely not correct, because MAPKAs and collateral may be possible, but there are simple clues here. You can see, what is this? BT shunt is correct, because these are the vascular clip scenes, and you can see there is a damage, there is a periosteal reaction in the ribs, and there is a rib deformity. So, and there definitely underwent still clubbing is there, central sinuses and the continuous murmur. So here the origin of continuous murmur is from the right BT shunt from the thoracotomy. So before seeing, that's what the, it looks like normal X-ray, but you can see there are the vascular hemoclips of the post previous surgical correction is there, and there is a rib deformity on the right side with the rib crowding and irregular rib. So from that, you have to take your clue from this normal looking X-ray. So MAPKAs and collaterals are not correct, but whichever told BT shunt, it's extremely correct for this. So this is a typical X-ray of right BT shunt from the thoracotomy, getting detected with the help of vascular clip and the rib deformity. From that we can tell. So now we go to next X-ray. Anybody wants to ask anything, they can ask in between with that, so I can tell you. These are the three post-op surgical patients, and whatever the marked is there, you have to identify ABC, what are these structures referred to. A, I'll give you 5 seconds, what this A referred to and what is done for. B. You have to see the course of the arrows rather than writing sternal wires. Course of the arrows, where it's pointing, on which structures there it's pointing. The all arrows in a shape. These are all three post-op patients we usually see in our ICU with all this. Okay. So it could be PA line, extremely correct, because this is the severe PH. We want to do PA, we want to check the PA pressure. So we put IJV deep, or you can write as a PA line or CVP line in the PA. And the it's a PDA clip, but you won't call it as a PDA clip, because it's a generalized hemoglobin, which is used for the duct closure, it's used in the different places also, not only for the PDA clip, but all the on the safer side, you can say it is a PDA clip, but it's a mostly hemoglobin, which is used for the duct closure. And the C is temperature probe. Nobody answered that, but this is when we are seeing the central temperature in the initial post-op period to know the low cardiac output of what the use of the central temperature in post-op cardiac patient. Can anybody tell? What is the use of the central temperature? How you differentiate the low cardiac output by seeing the central temperature as well as the peripheral temperature? Core temperature, peripheral temperature difference, how it determines the cardiac output state, okay, perfusion. So how you will determine, how you interpret that? What will be low? When the central temperature is high and the peripheral temperature is low, that is suggestive of low cardiac output state. But when suppose it's more than 3 degree centigrade, then what does it indicate? Normal, there is a difference 0.5, 1, 2, you can tell it's a low cardiac output itself. Typical, when you are not using for, when you are assessing the sepsis, that's a term in the cardiac intensive care. Whenever the central and peripheral temperature of difference is more than 3 degree centigrade, that is suggestive of septic shock, sepsis shock. When the difference lies between 1 to 0.5 to 3 degrees, then there is any generalized shock is the low cardiac output state. So the C is the temperature probe what we use to see to check the central temperature as well as the peripheral temperature difference in the immediate post-op period. Very correct. Nice. This is a nice one. 7 month old presented with right heart failure, equal air entry on both sides, normal breath sounds. Echo shows severe RV dysfunction, severe PAH, and normal pulmonary venous drainage. So what will your diagnosis here? If you want to ask any question from your side, query, you can tell, so I can repeat also. This is the X-ray of a 7 month old child, equal air entry on both sides, severe RV dysfunction, severe PAH, and normal pulmonary venous drainage. Okay, PPHN, correct. Then, any other possibility you think of? You have to see the clinical details given over here. Right heart failure, equal air entry, normal breath sound, and then see the X-ray, severe PH. It's a 7 month old. We are not using generally PPHN term for a 7 month old child until unless it's a persistent fetal circulation. Looks pneumo on left, that is not correct. It looks pneumo on the right. You can tell it's okay, but I give you very good clinical clue, equal air entry on both sides, normal breath sounds. If you have pneumo, can you have that and there is no pleural margin also seen? So now what will be your answer? I am giving clues here. Anyone wants to take it? Nobody is commenting now. Emphysematous right lung, okay. But if the emphysematous right lung, it will herniate once the one side is overflooded, left side is overflooded. Hyperinflation, you can tell, but I give you the clinical scenario, severe PH, severe RV dysfunction. So this is one of the rare cardiac condition which we saw in ophalumacin, it's an absent RPA. So there is a no flow absolutely to the right side and all flow is towards the left side. And this is the another X-ray with the similar pathology from the other patient. You can see it looks like a pneumo or it because there is absolutely no flow because the RPA is absent. Sometimes it won't supply by anything. So this is the one of the very rare or one of the important. We saw some 4 or 5 cases still now where the absent RPA, total absent RPA isolated, which will cause there is no flow towards the right side and because of that there is a severe PH and severe flow. The clue to the X-ray here is equal air entry on both sides. Emphysematous, hyperinflation and pneumo, sometimes you won't able to get it. Hyperinflation is also correct, but it's not absolutely flattened diaphragm. the both diaphragm is at the equal level. So once it's the hyperinflated one side, that diaphragm will be on the lower side as compared to other diaphragm. You can see in both axes, diaphragm is on the diaphragm dome is maintained. So the hyperinflation inflation metas is rare. So this is the clue here. You have to get it. It's the equal air entry. Now this is a 10-year-old girl, symptomatic with dyspnea and generalized NS-alpha, and the NS-alpha started from abdomen. So what is your diagnosis? This is very specific clues given, and there are very specific diagnosis. Can anybody comment on that? I'm still waiting for answers. You see, specifically lateral X-ray was also taken for this patient. So you have to keep that in the mind. Why for the same patient lateral X-ray specifically asked for? Okay, constrictive pericarditis. Anyone else? So what are the features you are telling is constrictive pericarditis here? Clinical history suggests you okay, I can take your point, but what are the X-ray clues in this to suggest? Suppose the history not given, the X-ray only will given to you, how you will tell it's a constrictive pericarditis with this X-ray, these two X-rays? Have you able to find out anything abnormal in the lateral X-ray? Very correct. See, these are the calcifications seen on the lateral X-ray. Absolutely, this is a calcification pericardial, and this child is having tuberculosis history also, and triangular heart and calcification. And this is the typical, see, this is the CT scan of the same patient that shows the calcification around the heart border, which is the most common site of calcification of constrictive pericarditis and why. This is the added question with this. Can anybody can tell what is the most common site for calcification in constrictive pericarditis and why? So I'm not taking much of it, I'll explain. The most common site is the AV groove. Why AV groove is involved there? Because the heart is got minimal exertion over there. Other LV apex and all, at least half is moved inside and outside. So there is a less chance of stasis and dystrophic calcification to set in over there. The most common site is AV groove, and this is the typical triangular X-ray of the constrictive pericarditis. So whosoever is commented, it's a commendable you saw that in X-ray. So that's why particularly lateral X-ray was taken, because sometimes in AP X-ray you won't able to see the calcification. This is the X-ray PA view. Tell me the diagnosis. Of a 2-year-old kid. I want other people to also participate, because all apart from 2-4 people, nobody is answering the questions. At least you can try. You may be wrong. That's how you will learn. I'm still waiting for the answer for this. Tell me the most important X-ray finding in this. AV malformation. See, AV malformation is a generalized term. What AV malformation, where, how, and how you know AV malformation of which? Hepatic, renal, brain. You have to be specific. Once the specific chest X-ray given, you have to write exactly about that X-ray. I'm still waiting for the answers from your side. I think these are the straightforward X-rays where it's a typical X-ray. Okay, Bhargavi wrote it's a correct, it's a pulmonary AV malformation. This is the angiogram of that, because it's a coin-like lesion. It's a large coin-like density in the right upper lower field. So this is the typical of pulmonary AV fistula or pulmonary AV malformation in the right upper lower. Correct. So two conditions with desaturation in pulmonary vein. There are only two conditions in cardiology where you will get the desaturation in pulmonary vein. Tell me the two conditions. Okay, if collateral is draining to pulmonary vein, I just want to answer if collateral is draining, how the pulmonary vein will get desaturated? It will be from the venous side. So if you are telling bronchial vein connection, it's okay. So it's a pulmonary AVM is very correct because I give with that. But what are the second condition most common? You will see desaturation with the pulmonary vein first or with other thing. Lung condition. So there are only two conditions. Whenever you will get the cath lab, you will get the pulmonary vein desaturation. There are only two conditions. Either any of the lung condition, either from the hypoventilation to lung pneumonia, that will cause the deoxygenation. So you will get the desaturation in the pulmonary vein. So in cardiology, you will get the pulmonary vein desaturation only in two conditions. First is any lung condition, because lung is the primary source for the oxygenation to the heart, to the body. That will be a desaturation. Second is the pulmonary AV formation. Second is sometimes there are rare causes like bronchial vein draining into pulmonary vein, but these are extremely rare. So they are the two, but that is the type of pulmonary AV malformation. So the two most common conditions which cause desaturation in pulmonary vein in cardiology is these two. So what are the three phases of an angiogram or any AV malformation or any artery venous connection? So there will be already artery, capillary and the veins. Okay, so once you have the pulmonary AV fistula, that capillary phase will be absent. The absent capillary phase is the characteristic of any AV fistula anywhere in the body, whether it be systemic AV fistula, pulmonary AV fistula, so that there won't be any oxygenation. So in this also the capillary phase is absent, so there won't be phase, so there will be absent capillary phase. So this is the typical of pulmonary AV fistula here. So whosoever corrected, it's very nice. These are the two patients referred for cardiomegaly on X-ray, but the cardiac examination is normal. Can you comment on the X-ray A and X-ray B? Still waiting for your answers. It's an easy one for which most of the pediatricians okay. Mediastinal mass is okay, but I wrote cardiac examination, cardiomegaly on X-ray, and there is a typical sign is also there. So A is thymus, that is absolutely correct, because there is the most common referral for cardiomegaly from the neonatal unit. And Dr. Iyanka commented very well, it's a expiratory film. It's not a rotated X-ray. But it's a expiratory film. You can see it's a dome of diaphragm is very much into the thorax, and just because the cardiac examination is totally normal. So this first is thymus, and you can see the very beautiful same sign for this thymus. And there is a notch. What are the other signs for the thymus? One is same sign. What are the different ways by which you can able to diagnose the thymus? What are the typical signs for the thymus? I already wrote here, one is same sign, which I depicted with that graphic. And second, this is a notch sign. You will always have an angulated notch wherever the thymus is meeting cardiac shadow. These are the two very common and very important X-ray signs for the thymus. Correct? And second is expiratory field. So these are the ends of the X-ray field end. But this is just the question at the end of this. What is the value of Reynolds number required to produce murmur? Can anybody answer? Reynolds number, okay, correct. Abhinav, you are very correct. This is 2000. Whenever a Reynolds number value is more than 2000, turbulence is there and that will cause the murmur. Excellent. In the section 2, let's play PQRST. What this picture shows is the first electrometer will each one decide over that. There's a, one of the largest, and we have to, from the Lippmann set. Okay. So this is an 11-year-old with history of scorpion bite. Identify the rhythm. I'll give you very specific clues. 11-year-old with history of scorpion bite. You can go always whenever ECG goes to broad complex, narrow complex, T waves are there or not there. What is the PA-QRS relation? Identify the rhythm. Still unable to get any answers from you. At least comment something. Okay, Sujata told it's a VT. Okay, so as per the dictum of ECG is very correct. Whenever any broad complexes, you have to take it granted as for the VT. But here the other clues are also there. What is the most important criteria for diagnosing VT? It's an AV dissociation. Do you think there is an AV dissociation here? So I'll let you know, these are the all arrows that are showing the P waves. P waves in presence of broad QRS scorpion bite. What is your answer now? ST depression is correct because it's a myocarditis is there, scorpion bite, and with this rhythm. ST depression is okay, but I want to identify the rhythm. What is that abnormality? So I'll let you know, this is known as intraventricular conduction delay, where the initial QRS complex is normal, but the later portion of the QRS is wide. Most common example is RBBB or LBBB. But when in absence of RBBB or LBBB pattern, still when the QRS is wide, in presence of 1:1 P QRS conduction with normal P wave, this is known as the intraventricular conduction delay. So in this scorpion bite, I'll again show you, you can see, here all the P waves which are normally present just before QRS at the normal place. But still the QRS is wide. So this is intraventricular conduction delay, non-specific, which can be present in all these conditions. Myocardial infarction, cardiomyopathy, myocardial fibrosis, myocarditis. Because the ventricular is inflamed, it will take long time to get depolarized. So then the conduction will get delayed. Initial slurring will be normal to start with, but because it got fibrosis, it is taking long time. So most common example is intraventricular window condition RBB or LBB, then that pattern is not there. You have to just call it as non-specific intraventricular conduction delay, which is found in all these. Okay, this is specific. We not give any shock, we not give any xylopart, we just started prazosin and some beta blocker after that it become normalized. Okay, so this is typical example of intraventricular conduction delay. Now this is one of the very important 1 week old neonate, insignificant antenatal internatal history, presented with shock, no pulses palpable. We got a call from the neonatal ICU to get the cardiac evaluation done. Identify the problem and what will be your plan of management after seeing this ECG. This is the typical ECG pattern you have to identify. Not getting any answers from you. I know ECG is difficult. It's not BF, you can see the P waves also over there, not VT. You can see the P waves in AVF, you see inferior leads, you can typically P and QRS are. Okay, so I'll let you know, this is typical serum potassium when we check, it's a 9. It is a typical ECG of an hyperkalemia, which is known as a sine wave pattern. Okay, so this is the typical X-ray at the different level, like first showing the five, more than 5.5, more than 6.5, more than 7.5, more than 9. It's a typical sine wave pattern where it's like again intraventricular conduction delay is present. Okay, so this is the, we just corrected with the bicarb, calcium and glucose insulin, and after 4 hours this is the ECG that's showing. So what we mean to say, you should not go always in thinking of doing something gross. Something gross is there, but you have to identify the main problem. Any issue is already, the lesson is you have to first see the clinical history as well as the electrolytes. This is one of the most important findings. Okay, so this is the sine wave pattern of the hyperkalemia. Now this is one clinical scenario, 3-month-old child with difficulty in breathing, history of recent RTI with feeble pulses, respiratory rate of 50 to 60, no organomegaly, chest is clear, but neonatal is about to intubate and waiting for ECG. But when we are doing, they called us for some another echo, but when we are passing through the monitor, we saw this pattern. Can you identify what is the most important finding on this monitor finding? Anyone? Extremely correct. It's a T-tall view. They are about to intubate. Chest is clear. No organomegaly. So there is a severe acidosis. It's a tachycardia with peak T wave. But this monitor shows many things. Like in the right, you can see SpO2, the perfusion index is very low. Tachycardia and peak T wave. Low pulse volume, poor perfusion index, tachypnea. So this all suggests we just give NS bolus of around 200 cc to 3 kg child, glucose, insulin, and the child become absolutely normal. And afterward, it turned out to be organic acidemia presented with severe acidosis and hyperkalemia. So whenever sometimes you have to keenly look on your monitor also to diagnose the problem, rather than just waiting for your ECG or just waiting for your ABG or just we are waiting for that. So you have to take a clues from your monitor also. This is just to show you have to take a keen eye on your own monitors. This is the SVT patient, we all know. But what is this represent? What this represent? On an ECG strip, what this represent? Because even I saw DM student and DNB student unable to answer this question. And what are the component of this? Okay, standardization is very good. Okay. So what are the components of this standardization? I want to tell you this. This represents standardization. So initial part, it's a 5 mm. The initial part will show limb leads and later part will show chest leads. And whenever showing this, 10 mm is equal to millivolts. Okay. So these are the all pattern you will see on the ECG. Either it's a full standardization, chest and limb lead, half standardization, both chest. So whenever, if you know the initial part is for the limb leads and the later part is for the chest lead, then only you will able to comment. So now this is the ECG comment about the standardization. What is limb standardization and chest standardization? I still not got any answers. Okay, very correct. Limb is half and chest lead is full. Okay, so it can given in that way also, but you can see the width is half. So you have to see. So that's why these are all examples. What is this? What this represent? In this, what the standard? Double standard is very good. Sometimes when you get the complexes very low, you are unable to see. You have to make it double standardization. But suppose you are unable to see, you have to see cursory on the lower side of the limb. It's written always. It's a limb 10 mm per millivolt and 10 mm. It's already written. So just it's to keep your eye on the ECG to make the correct measurement. This is one of the for which ECG measurement tangent method is used for. And why? Waiting for answer. ST segment, no, not correct answer. Any other taker? See, why this Tengen method? No, not QRS axis, that is wrong. Now, if I give the clue, you will be able to know. 2-month-old report to rule out any abnormality in view of death of 2 siblings. Now, everyone can tell what will be the this measurement used for which ECG measurement. QTC, very correct. So, why it developed? This is the typical ECG of a long QT interval. When QT is more than half of RR interval, you can know it's a problematic. So, why? Because if you are not taking tangent, sometimes you will overestimate. So the correct method of you have to put a tangent from the slope of the T wave. And then you have to take the base. Where it's cutting, at that point you have to take. So this is very important because to correct the QT. If you won't take when there's a thick ink, you will able to overestimate or underestimate. So to do correct measurement of QT, the tangent method is applicable. Okay. Point to be considered for calculation whenever they both intersect. Now, 12-year-old girl presented with dyspnea class 2 diagnosed with severe MR on penicillin prophylaxis, diuretics and digoxin. Good LV function with EF of 65%. What will be the diagnosis? Less time is remaining, so you can just okay. DGFR correct. Any other taker? This is the googly because. Because people may refer for you as a RHD, but you have to put your brain into that. What are these? This child referred to as severe MR for mitral wall replacement on penicillin prophylaxis, diuretics and digoxin, but having good LV function. But when we saw the ECG, here are the deep Q waves. You have to see 1 AVL, V5, V6 is the deep Q wave. So being a pediatric cardiologist, anyone refer for MR also, you have to take care of your Q waves and coronaries. So this is the typical X-ray or typical ECG of Alkappa. You can see there is a ST segment depression everywhere. And there is a Q wave. Deep Q waves in V5, V6, 1 and AVL. So this is typical of Alkappa, although the functions are maintained. So what are the causes for the late presentation of Alkappa? This is the ECO picture that shows is that Alkappa is there. Factors which determine the late presentation of Alkappa. Anyone else? Factors determining late presentation of Alkappa. What? PA pressure correct, colitis. Absolutely correct. So any associated lesions with that or presence of PH because of any cause, associated lesion and the presence of collateral. This patient underwent Alkappa repair, but when we did the NGO, we found out there are plenty of collaterals. When the surgeon opened the heart, there are multiple collaterals on the surface. But luckily, in spite of severe MR, the function was maintained. And this child was referred as severe MR for mitral wall replacement. So you have to put your brain, not simply just MR, but you have to think of the X-ray, these are the X-ray clues. So whenever any LV dysfunction, severe MR, these are the checklists. You have to rule out Alkappa, coarctation, Takayasu arthritis, arrhythmia, thrombus occlusion of the coarctation, hypocalcemia, collateral extracardiac shunt, any hypertension with burned out phase, non-compaction and beriberi. So these are the checklists for the LV dysfunction, severe MR unable to prove from any other thing. 1-year-old underwent ICR for TAR with no blood pressure after surgery having tachycardia. What is the rhythm abnormality? This is the easy one you will routinely see in your day-to-day practice. Clue is very clear, Jack, very correct. What is the name of the congenital form of this rhythm? This is the congenital Jack. Second part is, what is the name of the congenital form, which is very rare, but there is a specific name given for that congenital form. That is known as formal arrhythmia. Okay. Okay, next, 1 year old, room air saturation of 70%. Diagnosis, top physiology. Is this the plain top? Is it a simple or complex top? Waiting for your answers. Is it simple or complex top? It can't be simple top. You have to see the axis, which is superior axis is counterclockwise loop. So it's a top with AV canal defect or top with large inlet extension of the VSD. So it's not a simple top, it's a complex top. Okay. Because you can see in one and AVL there is a Q wave, that is a counterclockwise loop, or you can call it as GORV, but the axis is superior. The superior axis is always large inlet VSD or AV canal defect. So it's a top with AV canal defect. That's how you will differentiate a top physiology on the basis of. Okay. 2 days old, referred for rapid heart rate with biventricular dysfunction. The diagnosis is very clear, it's a SVT narrow complex. Diagnosis. Tell me the diagnosis. Very correct, it's an atrial flutter. We give adenosine bolus and see, after the adenosine bolus, there is a flutter wave which got apparent. This is an atrial flutter. Or you can cause an atrial tachycardia to begin with the initial ECG, but after seeing the adenosine, you are very sure it's an atrial flutter. So this child presented to us on day 2 with rapid heart rate biventricular dysfunction. We treated after the child becomes okay and got discharged. But this, what the importance of this? One more question, which is the enzyme required for the metabolism of adenosine? And where adenosine got metabolized? Enzyme responsible for adenosine metabolism and where that enzyme is situated. Okay. Actually, it's on the surface of the RBC, there is an enzyme, adenosine deaminase. Okay. So, it's correct. Okay, ADA, correct. Now this is a closing ECG question. What is the relationship of sinus arrhythmia with ASD? No, not familial. It's a very important clue. Whenever sinus arrhythmia is it's large as it doesn't have sinus, but large is 1, 2 is to 1 also, 3 is to 1 also, 4 is to 1 also. So there is a specific absent in case of ASD shunt greater than 3 is to 1. Whenever the shunt is more than 3 is to 1 in large ASD, you won't get the sinus arrhythmia. Very correct. Now this is one of the clinical case, 6-month-old girl, no neck holding, poor feeding, deeply sinus, report for cardiac evaluation. This is the clinical picture. This is the blood and this is the ABG. What is your diagnosis? PO2 60, methemoglobin image, very correct. What is the normal methemoglobin level in blood? So methemoglobin is one of the important clinical finding, you won't get the clubbing. And normal level is less than 3%. Whenever it's more than 3%, it's abnormal. Okay. Now, this is an infant presented with failure. What is the possible cause of failure you can think of? Those who used to treat, they are able to tell very clearly, because before 2-5 years, I am unable to diagnose this because I never saw this. But once you come to know about the geographical location of the country, what are the cases coming to your location, you will be able to know what the cause for this failure. Anyone? So very correct, it's a thymine deficiency. You can see the mother face. It's a callosis is there and child presented with failure. So once I came to Hyderabad 4-5 years back, I never saw any beriberi in my life. But in Hyderabad, there are 2 or 3 belts near in Andhra, Telangana. Like in Nalgonda district, you will find out fluorosis as well as thymine deficiency very common. Here when we saw the mother, it's very clear. The mother is having callosis and child is having failure symptoms without any cardiac problem. So once you give the thymine and general management, the baby will improve over the period. This is the diagnosis for thymine, beriberi. So now the cardiac catheterization. These are the 3 legends in the cardiac catheterization. We received the Nobel Prize for the cardiac catheterization. One is Crossman, Richards and Cournot. These are the some calculation we used to know. One French is 0.33 mm, 1 mm H is 1.36. The easy way to remember is everything is 33. Remember 0.33 mm, 1.133.33 and 1.3533. You can remember like that for all measurements in cardiac catheterization. Now this is the first question for you. What is the phenomenon of residual shunt after device before complete thrombus formation known as? You see, I am showing you the PDA device, but still after deployment of the device, angiogram is showing the shunt through device. So what is this phenomena of residual shunt through device before complete thrombus formation known as? You can see here also. Unable to get answers. I want answers from you. These are routinely you are seeing, so you should know the phenomena. Now people are interested more in intervention, so they should know more. See the lower panel, after some time it totally got closed, so you won't get the dye going through and through. Still waiting. So this phenomena is known as the foaming phenomena. Okay. Whenever this phenomena is there, you have to just wait for 5 to 10 minutes or use this for some minutes and then do the angio, so that it's totally closed. Because it still is going through mesh, it's not thrombus. So this is known as foaming phenomena on angiogram. Okay. Describe the branching pattern. Waiting for answers. Nobody is trying at all actually, that is wrong. At least you should try, whether you are right or wrong, then all you will come to. Right arch is correct. No, it's not a bovine trunk. Right arch can people tell, hemitruncus. It's very correct. It's not like an exactly hemitruncus, but you can call it as hemitruncus. There's a left innominate artery with 2 branches. This is the right RSA, RCC, all 3 branches, mirror image branching pattern is there, and that is the LPA, and it's an indirect duct. So it's a complete is right arch with left innominate artery, RCC, RSA, and left innominate artery base. You get the which is the most what is the most found pattern of PDA? It's a left indirect PDA, which is coming continuing as an LPA. So somebody wrote it's a right arch with hemitruncus. It's okay because hemitruncus, one of the branches coming from this side, but it's a complete. There is no separate vertebrae. Okay, so a good try. What is the abnormality on this angiogram? So one of the very easy already clue given to you here. Correct. It's a single coronary origin from the left sinus. There is no AR. Okay, that's the filling up of the non-coronary sinus you are tending for like an AR. You can see typically single coronary origin with coronary crossing the RVOT. The single coronary from left sinus with RCA crossing RVOT. What is the incidence of coronary abnormality in TOP? And most common coronary abnormality in TOP? That is a simple question, but you should know. Hello? Identify catheter and wire core. Then correct. Coronary branch causing RVOT is the most common, which is the normal variation also. And the most common is LAD from RVOT, but the incidence is only 3-5%. And coronary branch is 8-10%. Identify catheter and wire core. And what is the diagnosis? It's one of the very common findings in cyanotic CHD. Now you can tell. No, you have to see there is no LSVC. It's draining into the SVC only. So it's not bilateral SVC. It's a retroaortic indominant vein. Okay. Because when how you will see on echo, it's below the aorta. That's what the aortic, you have to take a clue. Pigtail pigtail is also given, as well as the it's going from the SVC to the indominate again to the left side. It's not a bilateral SVC. It's a indominate, retroaortic indominate vein. And how you will differentiate from the normal vein? Normal vein is draining at the higher level. Once you get the, your indominate vein is draining at the lower level, that is characteristic of retroaortic indominate vein. So the typical diagnosis here is retroaortic indominate, not LSVC, not bilateral SVC. Okay. So comment on this angiogram. Tell the diagnosis and complete angiogram. It's in the PA angio. No, not right AVM. You have to see the levophase very correctly. It's coming very late, draining into RA, correct? But how it's draining into RA? There's a typical almond shaped coronary sinus. So that is TAPVC or HAPVC, because you don't know from the other side through the coronary sinus. This typical shape is of the almond shape is for the coronary sinus. The levophase is draining into the RA. Once you call it as AVM, there should not be any delay. Okay, so it's a delayed contrast is coming. It's a levophase draining into RA to coronary sinus. It's a TAPVC or HAPVC to coronary sinus. Okay. Diagnosis and finding. There are two questions here. What is the diagnosis and what is the lung point? It's an easy one for pediatric cardiologist actually. Very correct, L kappa. But what is the lung finding? What that lung finding is known as? Lung finding. See, this is typical of L kappa. You can see there is a coronary coming from the proximal PA, and there is a huge cardiomegaly, as well as the lungs upper lobes are very congested. So that is the typical phenomenon when LV dysfunction, your pulmonary venous pressures are high. So what that phenomena known as? That is known as cephalization. That means your PA, your pulmonary vein pressure is more than 12 to 15. More than 15, you will get the cephalization. You see the lower lobe oligemia, because of the congested vein, your lower veins will be constricted, but the upper lobe will become more. That is known as reverse Mostel sign or Entler sign or cephalization. That is typically show grade 2 pulmonary venous hypertension. Grade 1, sorry. Okay. What is the diagnosis? IVC interruption is correct, but apart from that, it's not complete diagnosis. If IVC interrupted, it has to go somewhere. Now, how it's going? No azygous continuation. Heart is with levocardia, situs solitus heart. So what will call it as? IVC interruption, and where it's draining. Actually, it's a IVC interrupted with hemiazygous. Whenever it's on the left side, that is known as the hemiazygous continuation. And where it's draining? It's draining into the LSVC. So what that appearance of drainage of IVC interrupted to either RSVC or LSVC known as? The angiographic appearance, what it known as? What the particular pattern that known as? That is known as the candy cane appearance. Okay. Explain the procedure done in this patient. Anterograde flow, where anterograde flow? MPA. Why we need to do it, you have to understand. You have to see from where your cable is coming. That is correct. Device closure or MPA anterograde flow. In case of VDG, or you can call it as, there is no conduit seen, so you can do it. It's a Fontan also. It's cable from IJV into BDG into MPA, and this is a BDG anterograde flow closure. Correct. Device across pulmonary wall and MPA. Explain the procedure. Identify the hardware used. Procedure is very simple, but I want to know about the hardware. Second question, what is the hardware used here? No, there is no Raskin balloon. That is wrong. Raskin balloon won't look like that. And is the Raskin balloon wire compatible? No. I gave already clue to you. Now, only one balloon which is compatible with wire used for balloon atrial septostomy is over the wire Z5 atrioceptostomy balloon. That is correct. That is coming with new med or now with the brown technology. That is the only which is compatible with wire. Yes, Raskin balloon or Miller, they are not compatible with wire. There is a wire guided end hole Z5 atrioceptostomy balloon. This is a characteristic, they are 35 degree curve so that it can go even in smaller. The balloon is little smaller profile and easy to enter into the LA as well as accommodating in the small LA. Okay, tell me the diagnosis. The diagnostic angiogram. Truncus, okay, you can take a truncus, but what is the differentiating of the truncus? What is the most common? No, TJ is not there. See, we specially give clue, the aorta is at the normal. Truncus, usually it will be D malpose or something, it's on the right side, and PA is on the left side. So truncus may be one possibility, but you see the inset image also given here. This is the typical AP window, where you will see, okay. The two walls are seen, MPA is seen. Because the walls are not clearly, so I can give it maybe truncus, but the truncus, this root will be very dilated. This is not at all very much dilated. It's an AP window with normal branching pattern, no right arch. So the most common diagnosis is AP window, but we can give truncus because the wall is not well seen. When the both walls are seen, you can call it as definitely AP window. When one wall is seen, you can call it as truncus. Comment on this angiogram. No. See, you have to see one thing. Where it's coming? It's below the wall. Sinus of wall cell aneurysm will come above the wall. What this is? You will oftenly see it, but rarely you will see it as a closed septal aneurysm. That is very correct. This is comment on this angiogram and what auscultation finding can be audible in this patient. There is a membranous septal aneurysm with no defect. So there is no shunt. But what auscultatory finding can be audible in this patient? It's specific for this. This rare finding also. But auscultation also you should know. So typical, well, this is one of the cause for the non-ejection click, like MVP, like tumor blob, that atrial myxoma. So non-ejection click is very, sometimes very audible whenever the large aneurysm is present. Identify wire course. And that was not septal aneurysm because that is not RSOV because it's below the wall. Septal aneurysm should be above the aortic wall or through the aortic wall. Identify the wire course in this patient. Okay, descending aorta, PDRP, that is the correct. Even somebody can call it scolatal also is okay. Okay, it's very correct. So it's a femoral artery with descending aorta with PD or somebody can call it a collateral also and to the RP and pulmonary bed. Very correct. What is the important finding apart from small VSD in this patient? Is the LVOangiogram. Okay, elongated RV, very good. what elongated are we usually associated with? Okay, partial AV canal. But what is the, that is the diagnosis I want finding on this. Elongated AV canal is correct. Apart from BSD, what is the finding? You have to see systolic anterior motion of mitral wall. See, you can concentrate now here. See, so much excursion of the mitral wall. It may be anything. It may be just the same with mild HCM, with VSD, or it's a partial AV canal. It can be with elongated LVOT. That is correct. But what this angiogram means to see how the mitral wall negative shadow will look like. You can see now it's projecting into the LVOT. And it's a very long and it's redundant and coming into the systole, into the LVOT. So it's a systolic anterior motion of mitral wall which causes dynamic LVOT crowding. And elongated LVOT is also one of the findings. So it may be AV canal, it may be HCM, okay, with VSD. So just for the finding, not for the diagnosis. Identify twin procedure, identify both devices. In one patient, two procedures were done here. Identify twin procedure done here and identify both devices. VSD and PDO devices are correct. What are the devices used? ADA1, ADA2, correct. PDO device closer with duct occluder 1 and PDO with duct occluder. 1 year old, symptomatic with feeding difficulty. Give the diagnosis. Easy diagnosis. One-year-old with symptomatic feeding difficulty. What is this? The esophageal barium swallow. Vascular ring. That anybody can tell. But what is the diagnosis? There is only one diagnosis in this. So barium swallow done, feeding difficulty, anybody can tell it's a vascular. But where the indentation is there, so I have only diagnosis, specific diagnosis in this. No. Double arch, you will get indentation both anterior and posterior. Double arch is okay, but is what is the most common? Inter indentation, okay. So PA sling, the most common cause of the only condition where you will see the indentation on the anterior is PA sling. So inter indentation is very specific of PA sling. Okay, now wire course. It's an easy wire course. No, Dr. Yunker, it's not correct. You think IVC will go that high and IVC will take that turn? No. See, IVC will end at the level of diaphragm to heart. Or if it's interrupted also, it will end, but it won't go that curve. This curvature is very characteristic of arch. Now you can think of aorta, ventricle, atrium, SS. That is absolutely correct. Excellent answer. This curve is typical of arch. Any arch you enter one of the ventricle, either the single ventricle, LV2, RV2, VSD, whatever, and then you enter the RA, and SVC and innominate. It's very correct. Excellent answer. So arch, ventricle, RA, SVC and innominate. You the diagnosis. This is easy for a pediatric cardiologist. Waiting for the answers. It's correct. It's a cardiac PAPBC. You will see here the SVC thing in the small LA with the right to left shunt across the VS and all veins are coming into the coronary sinus. This is a typical subcostal view of cardiac TAPVC 2. That is also not complete answer. Cardiac TAPVC 2 coronary sinus. That is the correct answer. Just telling cardiac TAPVC is not correct. Now this is the echo with color interrogation and that is the contrast echo. It's very correct. IVC by mistake, surgeon did it. You can see the contrast from the IVC which is draining into the LN. Patch is on the IVC ridge. By mistake, rather than connecting to this ridge, they connected to the IVC ridge. Okay, so it's a IVC to LN. Very correct. Okay, what is the PO2 on ABG? When this IVC to LA, what is the first thing by which you can suspect? Even in ASD patient, when chest and everything is okay, you will get the low PO2. You will get the low saturation. It may not be very low in the initial period. May not be low cardiac output. But there the systemic, maybe when this patient happened, the saturation was 93. Just on the cursory look, we did echo, we find out that. So it's a systemic desaturation. It's very correct. Identify the structures. Identify the structure. On which structure it was focused. What is the structure? Identify the structure. It is subcostal view. This is commonly present, but we should know how to see it. That's the only. Waiting for your answers. This is ductus venosus. You can see on the lower side. Okay, very correct. This is the portal vein. This is the IVC subcostal. There is a connection from portal vein to the IVC. So that is the typical ductus venosus. Excellent answer. So now with this, which cardiovascular structure is having highest peak velocity during fetal life? No. PA, no. Wrong. Any other taker? Those who are doing regular fetal echo, they will come to know. No. It's not umbilical artery, not middle cerebral artery, not PA. It should be some artery. That is correct. The correct answer is ductal arch. if you see in the fetal cardiovascular physiology, the maximum velocity you will found at the ductal arch normally also as compared to all structures. And when you will consider it restrictive, when it's more than 1.5 millisecond and meter per second. So up to 210, up to sometimes 120 centimeter, 130, 140 centimeter also is normal. So the highest peak velocity during fetal life is found in ductal arch. Now this is the end, just something. Let's learn alphabets again. This is the one very quick session round where you will get the answers. You can write the only first letter, then you can search all in your literature. Now A is for abort artery. What is importance? Anyone? Okay, next. When bulboventricular foramen considered restrictive? And what is Fonda effect seen with these two lesions? It is again the revisiting alphabets, but in the setting of cardiology. A for abort artery, B for bulboventricular foramen, C for Fonda. For every alphabet, there is one question. What is the importance of abort artery when the bulboventricular foramen considered restrictive? What is the Fonda effect and is seen in which two lesions? No, walk tension is wrong. Supravolvular AS is correct, or you can write valvular AS also is correct. But the two most common lesions where you will see supravolvular AS and severe MR. The concept of Fonda effect is conversion of your potential kinetic energy into dissipation of kinetic energy. So whenever there is a posterior jet of eccentric MR, once it hugs the wall of the LA and when it go into the pulmonary vein, the energy will get dissipated. So Fonda effect is seen in severe eccentric MR and supravolvular AS, where it can seen as a difference in the pulse between right and the left to lower upper lip. So that is correct, but nobody gave the other two answers. D, delamination abnormality is seen with which lesion? Correct, Epstein's anomaly, very correct. Dot and I method is used for, I won't give the answers, this I am just saying you go and see, search. Abort artery, when bulboventricular foramen considered restrictive. When dot and I method is used for? See, nobody is taking. Equilateral imaginary triangle in ECG known as? Each of one's correct. Eddy sounds on auscultation is present with? PDA, correct. Fourier analysis in cath lab is used for? Fourier analysis is general term which used in chemistry, physiology, biochemistry, physics, chemistry everywhere, mobile everywhere. So this you should know. Grunzing is known for? He is the first person to do okay. Kufner factor is used for which cardiac calculation? What is Kufner factor? No taker. inching method is used for and described by? Is very easy auscultation, correct? Described by I won't tell this is you should know everyone should know juxtapose RA appendage commonly seen with I can tell you answer but this you can just copy ABCD DTGA correct but the most common is tricuspid atresia, DTGA complex, it's okay, correct. Vichenko classification described in which view? Which letter, left or right? You have to be very specific for views, left or right lateral. There's a left lateral, 90 degree, correct. Lipid abnormality associated with severe AS. So very simple, I already gave a clue, it's a lipid abnormality. Which metabolic abnormality associated with severe AS? It's a hypercholesterolemia and that too homozygous. Homozygous hyperfamilial hypercholesterolemia. Okay, that is present with the severe AS. Mouse sign is seen with. No taker, these are common. Mouse sign is seen with. Okay, Nora and Nora produce landmark research for. Nitinol comprises of nickel, how much titanium percentage? It's a nickel and titanium alloy. So Ni for nickel, Ti for titanium, Ol for alloy. It's a 55% and 45%. 55% nitinol and 45% nickel. Not titanium, sorry. Opening snap is due to O is for opening snap, which is due to is seen in MS, but what's the mechanism? You have to tell. Second, orthostatic hypotension is defined as postural hypotension. What is the definition of postural hypertension when you call it as postural hypertension? How much change in the systolic BP? How much change in the diastolic BP? For how much time you have to change the posture and keep in that posture? Fall more than 10 mm Hg in what? Systolic, diastolic, mean. Systolic is more than 20, diastolic is more than 10 when you are in that position for more than 3 minutes, correct. Prosthetic tilting wall of Indian origin is known as we should know all this question. Prosthetic tilting disc wall of Indian origin known as so very simple, it's a TTK Chitra wall. Good, correct. PH state is used for Okay, this we should know. Q-tip sign is used for denoting. Q-tip sign on echo is used for denoting. Note taker. Quanticore catheter is otherwise described as. You are multiple times you are using this catheter, you should know. What is quanticore catheter? Q-tip sign, I will tell this answer. Q-tip sign is used for comedone ridge. Comedone ridge is the ridge which is present between LA appendage and the left lower pulmonary vein. So that ridge is known as the comedone ridge. The echo, when you find it in an echo, that is known as Q-tip sign. Is not for left atrial mark, it's a normal sign which is present, used to denote ridge between left lower pulmonary vein, left pulmonary vein and the left atrial appendage. Quanticore catheter is otherwise described as, it's a marker pigtail. Marker pigtail, when it's a marked pigtail, that is known as the quanticore catheter. Okay, where there are two types of coming. The distance between two markers is either 1 centimeter or 2 centimeter. So quanticore catheter is the marker pigtail. Rev process is done for which condition? Very correct. DTG, VSD, LVOT. Very correct. Sinus arrhythmia is mediated by which cardiac reflux? Okay, that reflex is known as Bainbridge reflex. Okay, in physiology we used to read Bainbridge reflex. T wave is a bifid, important sign of. Bifid T wave is seen in long QT. Very correct. Brugada also correct. Trussler formula is used for. It's a type 2 QT syndrome where the T wave is bifid. So that is very correct. TA band, where it is correct. U wave on ECG is seen with prominent U wave on ECG is seen with hypokalemia. It's a normal. First of all, U wave on ECG is a normal and hypokalemia. Very correct. V notch on echo is seen with which condition? No, V notch is seen with severe MR. When severe MR jet is the profile you will take, because severe MR will go up to the pulmonary vein. So when severe MR is so high that the pulmonary vein, flow is also competing with that. So that notch is coming on MR curve, that is known as the V notch, that is suggestive of severe MR. Washout phenomena in angiogram is seen with. Collateral filling, that is very correct. Any competitive flow in the PA or anywhere it's known as the washout phenomena. Very correct. X-ray phenomena of atrial escape is seen with. What is atrial escape on X-ray? Name itself suggests it escape the atrium. It's seen in dilated LA. There is a grading of LA dilatation like 1, 2, 3. When it's the double density is 1, when it's reaching up to the RA it's 2. When it's crossed beyond the RA, LA appendage on X-ray, then it is known as the atrial escape. So atrial escape is the grade 3 LA enlargement. Y descent is steep in. Okay, severe TR is very correct and constrictive pericarditis. These are the two most common where you will get the steep Y descent. Very correct. what is Zucker catheter special characteristic and what it is used for? EP is okay, but what the specific importance? This is the catheter which can having hole also and the electrode also. So you can simultaneously measure the pressure as well as electrocardiogram, intracardiac electrocardiogram. So this is specifically when you want to do the diagnostic initial days, they want to use for the Epstein's anomaly. They have to put a catheter like Zucker catheter where it will record the pressure tracing also and it will record the intracardiac echogram also. This is also coming now. There are two catheters like that, Miller and Zucker catheter. That is the Lumund catheter with pacing and pressure. That is very correct. What is that point in cardiology is used in these two places? What is that point in cardiology you are using? Okay, that point is a very important point you have to know, everyone should know. So I'll tell, these are the Z points. Z point is a point of intersection on ventricular when you are unable to see the ventricular trace where in this it's showing. But just to demonstrate on ventricular pacing, what is the EDP? When you are taking the ventricular tracing with ECG on cath lab, when you want to know the EDP, you have to put a one line intersection point where it's cutting the tracing, that is known as the Z point. That is the first place. Second place, the lowermost point of the JVP is also known as the Z point. Third point, the zero reference point from where you take the all calibration, everything in the mid RA, in the mid axillary line, in the middle of the anteroposterior chest, that is also known as the Z point, zero point. So these are the three places where Z points are used. So you should know all those things. Okay. So with that, we are end of the quiz. So I just want to know from every one of you, is this useful or is this the proper way of teaching? I put as a quiz in a different format also. So thank you all for your kind listening. And please give your feedback at drsudeepverma@gmail.com.